Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Last Word. We've got two very important topics lined up for you. But before we turn our attention to the story from Delhi, let's talk about Kashmir one more time. And even though the Parliament has passed the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganisation Bill today, Section 144 is still in force, viewers, in the Jammu and Kashmir Valley. Security still remains a prime concern. So while India officially has done away with Article 370, the Parliament officially has voted on splitting the state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. The Valley of Kashmir is still isolated and cut off from rest of the country. The internet is down, landlines are down. There is absolutely no way to get in touch with people over there. Obviously, the cable is not working. Section 144 has still been implemented all of today, which means the group of people cannot travel together. But once your communication lines are down, you can't even figure out whether there is a doctor available, whether the close-by chemist shop is open. And so there are daily issues that the citizens of Kashmir are facing. So before we get into a conversation of whether all of this is needed or not, whether all of this security precautionary measures, Section 144 is a clamp down, or whether it was the need of the hour, let's get you what we could from the city of Srinagar. Remember, connectivity is really bad, so even for us to get through our reporters and bring you the reports is really, really difficult. Here is Priyank speaking to one of the shopkeepers about what the situation is. Take a look.
Well, all the city of Srinagar is on high alert. There's curfew which has been imposed in all these areas. Only the medical shops have been allowed to be open because the medical facility need not to be affected. But there's a problem which people are facing by approaching the hospital because they don't have any phone. And how will they approach the ambulances? And that is one of the big thing which people are worried about. Sir, aapki shop open karke rakhi, aapne kitne patients aa pa rahe hain?
Patients kafi aa rahe hain, so we are providing them medicines for the betterment.
What about the doctors? Are they able to approach the doctors?
No, everyone is not able to, but some of the hospitals are open and other clinics are open. So patients are able to get their medicines and all that. So we are here to provide them medicines and all the facilities we can provide them. Yes, all that.
Until how long you have been told that this can continue?
We don't know that. No information about that.
Many laborers, masons and carpenters who've gone to the valley and who go to the valley every year to earn a livelihood through labor work, they also obviously got stranded. Along with the tourists, they were asked to leave, but not all of them could leave on time. They've been stranded there for over 20 hours as transport continues to remain a big challenge to get out of the valley. Here is a report that Farid managed to send for us.
Things are going bad to worse for tourists who are stuck here, and also importantly for these laborers. Now, the mostly working class, they are masons, carpenters, laborers who come to Kashmir Valley every year during summers, earn their livelihood, their money and go back. But this time around, they don't know what has hit them. In fact, they were told to go back, and since yesterday, they have, with their bags, are staying here.
कल से हम परेशान हैं यहाँ पे ना कोई बस है ना खाने का सामान है जो भी पैसा कमाया था उसी को पास था
पैसा भी नहीं दिया
नहीं दिया ऐसे जा रहे हैं हम
कितना पैसा रह गए हैं
6000 रुपए रह गए हां जी
तो वापस जाने के लिए आप खुद डर से जा रहे हैं
कुछ नहीं नहीं मकान मालिक ने भगाया बोला खाली करो यहां से
खाने पीने की चीज नहीं दे रहे गाड़ी बोले गाड़ी है
गाड़ी है
बोले आएगी शाम तक ने खाने पीने किसे कुछ नहीं दिया
And it's not just about those who are in the valley. Their family members, their friends and relatives who are in rest of India are struggling to get in touch with those in the valley. Mira now earlier spoke to a couple of worried Kashmiris whose families still reside in the valley for several days now. Ijaz and Zahid both have not been able to get in touch with them as the phone and internet services are completely down. Ijaz is based in Mumbai. And Zahid is a student based in Pune. Here is what they told us a little while ago on the Urban Debate.
Do you have family in Kashmir?
Yes, my parents, siblings all...
Are all there?
Yeah.
How old are your parents?
They're around in late 50s, 58, 60. Yeah.
Okay. Have you managed to reach them at all?
Not at all. Since Sunday evening, that was the last time I talked to them. I made a long video call with them because there was an apprehension that these curbs will be put on internet connectivity and all. So I did a long chat with them, almost a couple of hours, so that I was sure that something is going to happen because it was already in the air. So that's the last time that I talked to them. I'm really worried. I'm not able to talk to them. I'm not able to reach. No landlines are working. No phone calls, no internet, nothing is. I'm not able to. No, I have no information as to what is going on.
No information
there.
Now for 3 days.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, I also have Zahid Butt with us, who's a student who lives in Pune right now. Zahid, good evening and thank you for joining us. I want to understand, Eid is on Monday. So, Eid ke koi plans banaye the aapne apne parivar walon ke saath Kashmir mein? Kya aapki baat hui hai kisi ke saath pichle 3-4 din mein?
मैम, मैं रिसेंटली कश्मीर से कल ही आया हूँ. तो जम्मू कश्मीर में संडे नाइट से सारे फ़ोन कॉल्स बंद है, सारे इंटरनेट सर्विसेज बंद है, सारे ब्रॉडबैंड लाइन्स बंद है. सब कुछ जम्मू कश्मीर में सीज किया हुआ है. हर दुकान सीज की हुई है. सब कुछ बंद कर दिया गया है. जबकि 12 तारीख को यही हफ्ते में ईद है. तो घर वाले, जब हम एयरपोर्ट निकलते हैं तो एयरपोर्ट पहुंचते पहुंचते लगते हैं 10 मिनट, लेकिन हमें कल 1 घंटा लगा एयरपोर्ट पहुंचने में, क्योंकि हर जगह हर स्टॉप पे हमको रुकाया गया और चेक किया गया. हमारे पास टिकट थी तो तब हमें आगे जाने दिया. तो इतनी कंडीशन, इतनी वर्स्ट कंडीशन इस बार कश्मीर में बनाई गई है. इतने सारे लोगों को ऐसे बंद रखा गया है, ना इंटरनल मूवमेंट होने दे रहे हैं, ना कुछ होने दे रहे हैं. तो ये सारी चीजें इस टाइम कश्मीर में हो रही है.
Those are some of the voices we managed to get and reports that our reporters and our correspondents sent from Srinagar. Of course, the biggest talking point, viewers, in India tonight is, have the voice of Kashmiris been kept out of this major policy decision? Why isn't anybody asking the Kashmiris what they really want? Is this clampdown? No internet, no landlines, no connectivity. Section 144 restricting movements of people, troops standing every 20 meters. Is all of this necessary? That is the question we will ask tonight as well. But here are some facts that I want to present to you, some facts that I want you to think about. And Burhan Wani was killed. The valley burned in the summer of 2016. There were curfews and shutdowns, unrest that led to 100 deaths and thousands being injured. Many innocents, and everybody agrees on this, were caught in this crossfire. When in 2010, 17-year-old Tufail Ahmed Mattu was killed, that death triggered unrest as well. More than 120 people were killed. In fact, in the last 7 years, there have been a series of such instances of violence, of complete shutdown of the city. Specifically for the internet shutdown, there have been 178 instances of internet shutdown having been recorded in the state. Though I suspect there have been more than that. But the government now tells us that with their efforts in the last few years, the militant activity is reducing. In fact, as per a government statement, after Balakot, the militant activity has come down 40%. So in the light of all of these, this, the reality of Kashmir, knowing how sensitive the state is, should the government have really waited for the law and order situation to flare up before acting? Should the government have announced their intent that they very well know a few antisocial elements would have misused to light the fire, to create havoc? Or like the other side says, is this the way to integrate a state in our democracy? Let's debate. Sushant Sareen, Senior Fellow at Observer Research Foundation, joins us this evening. David Devdas, author of The Story of Kashmir, with us. And Anoop George Chaudhary, former Advocate General of Madhya Pradesh. And let me start with Sushant on this one. Sushant, do you think that the steps that the government took, even though they kept us in dark and kept everybody in dark about what it was, even though the governor insisted no policy change will be made, was all of that necessary? Is all of that necessary today after the bills have been passed?
No, what the governor said before the bills were passed and what the government did in keeping everybody in the dark, clearly they don't need to do that anymore because the cat is out of the bag. What the government was planning is clearly such a tectonic shift from what it was in the past that I think they did apprehend that there could be a breach of peace, there could be widespread violence, violent demonstrations, and the government, perhaps there's been a bit of an overkill, but as David will tell you that you can't ever estimate or anticipate how much the violence will be, so there's been abundant caution, but like I said, a bit of an overkill. But clearly, you know, you can't be taking such a huge step and then, you know, publicizing it beforehand. So I think that secrecy was very much probably required.
Hmm.
But having taken this decision, I think as with a couple of days more, maybe a week or so, 10 days, I think things will start getting relaxed. I can completely understand and appreciate the predicament that people find themselves in. But again, as David will tell you, this is not the first time something like this is happening. You spoke about Burhan Wani and the violence which broke out at that point of time. Even then, for months altogether, there was curfew, all sorts of things were happening. So this is not the first time, and I'm not defending that this is the right way to go about it.
Hmm.
But I suppose, given the kind of disturbed conditions that have existed in the valley, this is the way the government has decided that it can handle the law and order situation or prevent the law and order situation from spiraling out of control. Finally, having taken this decision, I don't see any way anybody can go back on it. The only thing is that how does it unfold from here on? And as and when, the kind of clampdown or the lockdown which is there right now in the valley, that starts getting lifted, will things remain cool and calm? Certainly we should expect some amount of demonstrations, some amount of protests. That is par for the course. Or will the valley simply explode and, there'll be a huge law and order problem? I don't think anybody can predict one way or another how the cookie is going to crumble on that one.
Yes, and so maybe on that front, you know, a lot of people would ask that how does then taking these steps help you today? And let me take that point across to David. David, one can't say that this was sudden. Everybody saw it coming. Nobody perhaps knew exactly what the government had in mind. But they did take 2 to 3 days to get the Amarnath Yatris out. They did tell the students living in hostels to shut down and go back homes, get to safer locations. They did tell tourists. In fact, we got reports that the district officials were actually going to one hotel and the other, telling the tourists that you should get out in the next 24 hours, find a way to go back home. So all of those measures were taken. And then for those who live in Kashmir, these restrictions have been imposed. Do you think this will help? Or the day you lift these restrictions, one doesn't know what happens then?
It was at the end of July that the Amarnath Yatra was suspended. It seemed for about 4 days. The initial report was that it was going to happen because of a landslide along the route from Jammu. One can say for sure that it began to be clear that something really big was going to happen over the 3 or 4 days before it happened, but nobody was sure. I believe that very, very few people within the government even had any idea of what was afoot or what was actually going to happen. Let me say also that this has been extremely odd timing, not to say bad timing, in light not only of the Amarnath Yatra, which brings a lot of people to Kashmir from all over the country, but also the tourist season, and on the other hand, Eid, which is only 6 days away now. This is a time when the streets of Srinagar and other cities across the valley would have been bustling with people, traffic jams at great length. It would have taken people 3 or 4 hours to get through those traffic jams at times. Now it is taking people 3 or 4 hours to get past the kinds of hurdles that are there, the kinds of barricades that are all over the place. This is unprecedented bandobast that has happened. I don't think it has ever happened in the past. There was an uprising in 1931. There were uprisings in 2008, 2010, 2016, and at various times before this. Never before has this kind of bandobast taken place. Let me also say that this is a great challenge. This is only, let us say, day zero. It is from tomorrow and thereafter. Once, and particularly once these restrictions begin to be lifted, that the real challenge will emerge. This is also a very bad time in terms of the international scenario. China, on the one hand, very iron brothers with Pakistan, as they keep declaring. They have made a statement today objecting to the division of the state. On the other hand, Mr. Trump playing footsie with the Pakistanis, and of course the Afghan situation, the Taliban on the brink of taking over power, and the Iran situation, which is causing perhaps Mr. Trump to get closer to Pakistan. These are all international factors that ought to be taken into consideration. We are still in a very, very challenging period and will continue to be for a while. Kashmiri mentioned that this kind of thing, people are generally in shock, if not in grief, and they are terribly upset at what is happening. But once the shock gives way to anger, there might be repercussions which will take time to come up, but those repercussions are likely to come up at some point. This is also a time, let us remember, when the militancy on the ground in South Kashmir has been veering a little more towards radical kind of Islamism. Ironically, after the killing of Zakir Musa a couple of months ago, his Ansar, Ghazwatul Hind, and other radical pan-Islamist groups have gained ground a little bit. It's not as if they have large numbers. They may only have about 20 militants with them at this point, but even that is maybe double what there was when Zakir was still alive. These are all portents of dangers ahead.
So let me just ask this again, David Devdas. What should have been done if the government has decided? And I don't want to right now, tonight, we debated a lot about the merits and demerits of Article 370, having it and not having it. But if the decision had been made, and like you said, times are still sensitive, the militants that we are seeing today are a lot more radicalized. Shouldn't the government have been this precautious and sent in additional troops?
Well, I would have done it in November or thereafter.
Okay.
Winter is a time when you would have had very few tourists. A lot of the migrant labor come there for the summer and go away around October. The government would have shifted to Jammu by the end of October. So it is November thereafter when the cold itself acts as an inhibiting factor. Remember that apart from all the factors that I mentioned before, Eid and the Amarnath Yatra and the tourist season, this is also just about the beginning of the apple season.
Yes.
And apple orchards provide a lot of the wealth that comes to the valley over time. This, of course, may be one of the factors that has gone into calculations, but over the next 3 or 4 months, normally, the apple and other fruit products, dry fruit products as well, would have been moving out of the valley in very, very large volumes.
And that obviously that will impact their livelihood, that will impact the trade for the valley, will end up perhaps, and let's hope it doesn't, but will perhaps end up culminating into
November
a lot
might
more
have been a
anger.
Better time or thereafter.
I take your point. Actually, that's a very valid point, that perhaps the timing could have been different, but maybe the government had other political compulsions, keeping in mind that there was a lot of speculation that J&K too may have elections by the end of this year. Let me tell you, Anoop George Chaudhary, always a pleasure to have you on the show. What's your view on this debate? A necessity, all of this clampdown, or an overreach?
Before I answer your question, Tanvi, I'd like to bring one point to your notice. 370 has not been done away with. Please, that's a misimpression that people carry. 370 is there. In fact, this order has been passed, issued under Article 370 itself. So 370 has not gone anywhere. And like 48 other orders that were issued under 370, this is one of them. There's no doubt that Shant said this now, that it was really a bit of an overkill. Well, I think that itself is an understatement. I don't think it was a bit of an overkill. It's quite a huge overkill. And of course, probably the compulsions which the government was, it seems as it now, because with their past experience, they were not very sure how this whole thing would blow up in their face, or what would be the extent of the protests, and how violent the protests would be, or how peaceful they would be. It all depends. So that's how they're doing, closing all the institutions, and everything else is just absolutely, I would say, Kashmir is at the moment dead. Absolutely dead. There's hardly a soul moving around here or there. But then again, you must also realize that this is happening in Kashmir, no, not to this extent at all. But then the government possibly was not very sure, and they wanted to be doubly sure and be abundantly over-cautioned.
Mm.
I would say abundantly over-cautioned for the reason that they just wanted to bring in as many security forces as possible to ensure that nothing happens at all.
Right.
But like I agree with David when he says here that they could have chosen a better time.
Okay.
And just before Eid to bring this, it's really, that's a little too much. And, but that's what there is now, except for the fact that we can criticize that this is...
I can see that Sushant is disagreeing. But let me just check if we can go across to Mr. B.L. Vora, former DGP. Mr. Vora, good evening. Apologies for the delay in our camera unit reaching you. But what is your own sense? Is this an overreach or a necessity? The additional troops, the kind of restrictions taking away all modes of communication from the Kashmiris?
Well, good evening. See, my view is it was absolutely necessary. This was minimum necessary. I have dealt with situations whole of my life. And government, whether it is timing, whether it's the steps taken, whether the troops sent, a lot of factors which are in the knowledge of the government, which we people will not know who are sitting on the TV channels. Of course, sitting from a distance, whatever my panelists are saying, I might agree with them. But I think, based on my experience, that it was absolute necessity. It's a good thing they did it, and it will be for a few days only. And slowly, I think the curfew will relax. And today, I even read even Amit Shah said that Farooq Abdullah has not been even arrested. I mean, he is giving interviews and all.
Correct.
So I think it is absolutely necessary. See, they will know all the factors must have been taken into account.
So, Mr. Vora, here is the point. And everybody is wondering, how long will this continue and what happens when these restrictions get lifted, because you still have the same Omar Abdullah and Farooq Abdullah.
This will depend on the intelligence inputs, frankly. This will depend on the intelligence inputs. But my guess is it's a matter of maximum few days. That's it. In any case, not more than a week or 3-4 days at best.
Yes, but what happens when the 10,000 or 20,000 additional army troops and Central Armed Forces troops leave, but you still have the Abdullahs and Muftis claiming that how this is trampling over democracy and taking away the identity of the Kashmiris?
Let them come out, then only we will see how much following they have, how many people are there to follow them.
Right.
After all, the point is this is all a speculation. So I think that government has taken a calculated risk also. And when it will be relaxed, I think it will depend on the intelligence inputs. But my guess is another 3-4 days.
Yes.
I think everything will be lifted, the curfew and all.
Okay, please do stay on with us, if possible, on the phone line. Sushant Sareen, you were disagreeing with the other point that was raised by two of our panelists, that perhaps the timing could have been better. Why do you disagree?
Look, there is, you know, when you're taking such a momentous decision, there is no perfect time. Maybe what David is saying might turn out to be right, maybe not, because as Mr. Vora is saying, that there were a certain international developments which were also taking place, and I think they kind of precipitated the decision to move forward with whatever the plan which has unfolded. So clearly, frankly, on the China factor, I think the statement which has come out for China is partly a reaction to the reference to Aksai chain by the Home Minister.
Yes.
So the Chinese are saying that, look, don't mess with the Xi chain. But other than that, what have the Chinese said? It's a pretty anodyne statement they've issued insofar as Pakistan is concerned. So I don't think the Chinese want to really wade into this, except for the fact that they want to make their position very clear, because they have many problems of their own with the Americans, with Hong Kong, with a whole lot of other things. The Pakistanis will do what they will do. And for the Indian side, I think there was this very serious concern that, you know, the developments in Afghanistan and according to reports, there is this speculation that perhaps by the time Eid comes, the Americans and the Taliban will enter into some kind of a deal and the Pakistanis would have been crowing. And there was that serious fear that the Pakistanis would be diverting some of these characters into India. So that probably kind of pushed, this entire thing forward. On the other question of what will happen, I agree that maybe a couple of days more, I think gradually they'll start relaxing the curfew, the restrictions. They'll probably open internet much later, but at least they'll open the phone lines. And that kind of a gradual relaxation will happen. And perhaps the hope is that, you know, with this kind of a decision having been taken, a couple of days more, it'll start sinking in. The shock will also be over, but people will also realize that while a lot has changed, in some ways nothing has changed. Life will pretty much go on as normal. So that is the hope. But like I keep repeating myself, there will be unintended consequences. There will be things that you have not factored in, which is why you needed to pump in the kind of security forces you've pumped in, right, in a place which was already awash with security forces. So there is an apprehension that things could spiral out of control, and then you need every man you have to try and cool tempers down to bring the situation back to normalcy. But if nothing of the sort happens, I think many of the troops that have been inducted will start getting de-inducted within a matter of weeks, perhaps a couple of months. So I think what the calculation is. But again, we'll have to see how things actually start unfolding when, you know, the relaxations are lifted.
Okay, let me just read out some of the, people who reached out on social media to talk about what they were going through. These are people who are living in different parts of the country and the world, but not in Kashmir. They have family back in Kashmir. And one person said, day two, no contact with parents or anyone else in Kashmir, complete radio silence. You have no idea how that feels. Another tweet said, it's one of those days when I wish I was a kite so I could fly to Kashmir, where home is, and see if my parents are doing okay under a military siege laid by the world's second largest army. Another one said, have not been able to contact my family back home due to communication blockade and internet shutdown. There's another one which said, in parting conversation with parents, despondency was deep. They said, don't come for Eid. What's there to celebrate in a siege? Phones won't work. Life will be curfewed. There was another one which said, today my six-year-old son was asking me if his grandparents are coming from Kashmir tomorrow for Eid as was planned. He has been waiting for them for over a month. What should I tell him? Because I don't really know. No contacts in fortnight. I will be at the airport waiting. Now, I understand what many people may be going through, maybe to a certain extent, maybe they're right. We don't understand because we don't have family stuck in a place where communication lines have been completely shut down and we have no idea what's going on for 48 hours. But think about it in another sense. And Mr. Chaudhary, we have seen enough of those scenes unveil in Kashmir as well, where people are going about doing their own things. Children, young children are coming back from school. Somebody's gone to the hospital. Somebody's gone to shop for their daily groceries and gotten caught in the crossfire between stone pelting and forces reacting and gotten injured. So isn't it better if the government takes precautionary measures like this to ensure that we don't have that kind of a collateral damage?
I think you are right in a way that the government probably wants to be sure that there should be as less collateral damage as possible, as you say. And in these circumstances, the collateral damage always affects those who are of the weaker kind, you know, the women, the children, and those who are the poor people, etc. So government probably wanted to be sure that such a thing never happens. Maybe it's like the DGP said, what goes on in the government's mind, we do not know. But looking to the entire, the factoring in all the possible possibilities that might arise, the government probably wanted to be double sure that we would not let any collateral damage take place. We try to curb this thing at the moment, at least. Future is very difficult to predict how what's going to happen. And like David says, we don't know what future holds for those people, how people would react. There will be people who will be trying to incite this whole situation.
Right.
The Huriyat is already waiting on the wings. They're waiting, yeah, absolutely. And they have always been inciting, as we all know, how Huriyat reacts. Huriyat's children study outside Kashmir and all the schools are closed down by them. So this is also one of the reasons why I personally feel that the government must be wanting to curb as much damage, or rather, should I say, curb the damage so that less of damage could be caused. That's what I personally feel.
Okay, one quick comment before we wrap this conversation up from David
as well. Can I just ask you a question? Can I ask you a quick question, please?
Yes, Sushant, go ahead, please.
Okay, you know, this thing which you just, this question which you just asked about collateral damage, I really am very interested to know how many stories, and we know the kind of journalists and the kind of stories they've been writing in some of our national newspapers. So my question to them has always been, and nobody has answered this question, have they ever covered a story of a guy who was not caught bringing milk in the evening, coming back from playing cricket, gone for tuition? You know, these are all the sob stories which are given. But when you see actual pictures of people who've been pelting stones, who've been part of these stone pelting mobs, actually murderous mobs, there have been people who've been wearing school uniforms, there have been all kinds of other things. So I have never seen a guy who's got injured who claimed that, yes, he was actually indulging in stone pelting and that is why he got injured. Everybody, and all these stories which are published in newspapers, and I don't think you want me to name those newspapers on your show, are all these sob stories to create a certain kind of a narrative which feeds into the kind of separatist narrative with many of these people who act as the
overground
face of the underground want to feed.
You got
me
wrong. I don't think it's a separatist narrative, firstly.
Collateral damage and stuff
firstly,
like that.
Are you suggesting then that everybody who gets injured or gets caught in this crossfire is a genuine stone pelter who is on Pakistani payrolls?
In virtually every case, it is that is the
because
case.
I think Prashant has been with you. And I'm speaking from personal experience, but
absolutely.
In any place in this country or in this world, there will always be people who get caught in this crossfire. There will always be people who are going about doing their own thing. I'm not saying everybody who gets injured and gets, like you said, reported as an innocent caught in the crossfire is not a stone pelter. But are you saying then that the government should not have put in these restrictions and should have let everybody out on the streets?
No. Question is,
I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that please be very careful, because in this war of narratives, there's a lot of other kind of things which slip in, and we need to be very careful of the kind of narratives which people try and create. So yes, I believe that there might have been, as somebody mentioned, overabundant caution, and yes, there has been a clampdown, and nobody is very happy for it. But given the kind of security situation which could unfold or which could spiral out of control, I think the government in its wisdom decided that they need to go in for this, let tempers cool down, and the restrictions will be lifted.
Yes, and how I see merit in the government decision is to say that the
common man who doesn't want to get caught, who doesn't want to be pelting stones, does not step out when there is ruckus.
For example, there are now reports emerging, and some of the media organizations have pointed it out, that there have been instances of stone pelting, minor instances with no casualties. But imagine if everybody had been going about their daily life, and these stone pelting incidences would have happened, the kind of impact that would have had on those who don't want to be a part of it, the kind of impact it would have had on the forces whose job becomes even more difficult to deal with the lawbreakers and the stone pelters, because there are others who are involved and on the street at that point of time, simply to make their job easier, simply to avoid the number of high casualties. I believe this step has been taken, and everybody who's crying foul about this significant and excessive clampdown needs to think about that scenario, that had these precautionary measures not been taken, what would the backlash have been because of just those few antisocial elements and the narrative that Sushant was actually talking about, and that narrative. Imagine those messages on WhatsApp. Imagine those messages on Twitter, those text messages. Imagine those rumors going all around you, telling you what the Indian government is planning to do and what the army is planning to do. And imagine the backlash to that. Now, there is nothing to suggest that once the restrictions are lifted, similar rumor mongering may not lead to eruption of clashes and protests. We don't know if tomorrow the valley will erupt in a clash or there will be backlash. But one can only hope that this transition period goes with as less damage as possible. Thank you for joining us on debate number one. We move on to debate number two.